checking en route to the station.
Tell him to hurry, she's burning the wall. We can't get her out.
I'm gonna try to pry it open. Bring her out. I'm gonna try to pry it open.
That the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you've told me who I am. I am yours. I am yours. Who am I that the eyes that see sin would look on me? The calm the sea would call out through the rain and calm the storm in me. Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. Because of what you've done, not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Catch me when I'm falling. You told me who I am.
Hi, my name is Jamie, and I'm here to tell you guys my story. Before June 27th of 2010, I was a normal woman, multitasker. I could do it all, and I did. I did it all. I worked way too much. I volunteered. I'll forget church on Sundays. I'll work on Sunday. I'll make the work week better for everybody. I eventually then put my family behind. My children became second fiddle. I was so busy. I made myself busy. I loved to go to the Ranger games and go play bowling. And not only did I work hard, I wanted to play hard too. I wanted to do everything. I was always on my laptop. I always had my cell phone. Wherever I went, I was always texting, always talking. When I drove to work and when I came home from work, it was charged in my car and my phone was on my lap the whole way home. Because I was a professional at multitasking. I could do it. I could handle it all. And that's when my life changed forever, on June 27th, 2010. My car went off the road, hitting a culvert. It flipped a couple of times and landed against a small tree where I was pinned inside and it caught on fire. Watching the video, it took the officers about 10 minutes to show up, and I was already engulfed in flames. My car was already in flames. It took them roughly 10 minutes to finally get free me from the vehicle. Using a crowbar, you heard the fire extinguishers. They used 6 fire extinguishers in the chaos of it all. They used that on my face and my chest from it burning. They finally freed me from the vehicle, and it took another 10 minutes before even the fire department showed up, before the volunteers could get there. Thank God I was out by then, or else I would have burned my life. Where my car had landed, it was right next to a little creek bed of water, and that's what these men used. There was other bystanders that stopped to render aid. And they're the ones who called 911. Thank God they were there. And I was right next to a little creek bed of water where they were getting buckets of ice chests and going back and forth together with this water, this dirty creek bed of water, to pour on my body. And I was airlifted to Parkland Hospital. And I didn't know what was going on. I was out for 10 weeks. I was in an induced coma for 10 weeks after that. And during that time, my parents were told I wasn't going to survive, that I wasn't going to live through this. I was on life support for a couple of weeks, and they became permanent chair fixtures in the waiting room. They could only see me every 3 hours for 30 minutes at a time, and they would come in and caress my body. What wasn't burned, they could touch some of my feet. They would tell me things and encourage me and uplift me, and when I woke up, I noticed that there was a difference. I knew I had been in a car accident. I do remember the certain sounds of it. The sounds of the feet running, the men running back and forth trying to save me. They weren't giving up until they rescued me. I remember the face on the man who pulled me from the vehicle, and I remember hitting the ground, and then that was it after that. I don't remember being burned, thank God. They gave me amnesia medication. I was on every kind of tube and everything imaginable. I had catheter, I had a feeding tube, I had a tracheotomy through my neck. Every 3 days, they had to move the central lines that were sewn into my neck. So I had to have that stitched in every 3 days. Both sides of my neck down to my groin, every 3 days, constantly moving, constantly sewing that into my body. And I started developing many challenges when I woke up. I noticed I was nice. I realized it was an accident, but I was bandaged up. I didn't understand what being burned meant. I didn't get it. There was no way I understood that. And my parents were there to encourage me. They would try to feed me, and that wasn't happening. So I was getting sick from the feeding tube. Face many challenges. You go through a psychosis when you're in the hospital just laying there for so many days. So lots of times people were trying to kill me. I was scared to death. I couldn't say anything for a while being on the trach. They didn't have a speaking trach in. So I just mouthed words. They didn't understand what I was saying. I was trying to communicate to them. And showing up at Parkland, I worked at Baylor. There was, well, I was not at Parkland. I didn't get it. And my dad told me that, and I got insurance. What am I doing here? You know, I worked at Baylor. I'm supposed to be there. I didn't realize until I got a little better. I went to the burn acute unit, acute care unit, where they could take care of me there. And I started understanding the feeling of being burned. Some of that started coming back. I was on heavy medication. And the feeling started coming in of therapy. They'd come in and try to work my arms. They'd get me up. I couldn't walk yet. I had burned my Achilles completely in two. I was burned from the top of my head, my arms, the tips of my ears burned. My arms down my back, my bottom, the tops of my thighs, down my right leg. And all that, third and fourth degree burns, which means every layer of skin was burned. I burned my muscles. My muscles were burned all the way to bone in some places. And that's pretty bad burns. It's nothing like getting burned on the stove. And going through the process of therapy and coming out of the drugs that I was on so heavily, they took me to what's called the tank. Here, they have to lay you on a metal slab table and wash every part of my body. Every part, I still had open wounds. Some skin grafts were already there, but a lot of it was still open on my back and in many places. It's like skinning your knee and your mom having to rub that area raw for day after day after day to make sure that an infection wouldn't come in. So I was like that. I was rubbed, I was scrubbed every day. And I would just think, oh my gosh, how can I handle this? I can't go through this. Lord, please just take me. I can't handle any more of this. And I would go through that. I would go through some more psychosis. I think there were bugs crawling in my mom's hair. Just scared to death. And after the tank, I would go through more therapy, walking. They reattached my Achilles. They started walking me the next day and getting me mobile, start moving again, and it hurt. When you're in a bed for so long, your body postures, your legs, you get stiff, you get frozen. And they have to break through all of that to get me normal again, to get me walking again. So I get a little better, and after the acute care unit, they send me to the rehab floor. And I was in the acute care unit for about 3 months. My total stay was about 6.5 months in the hospital. I go to the rehab floor, and it's just the same, but it's more hardcore therapy. I'm walking more. It's hard for me to walk down a hall. I get exhausted. I just wanted to sleep all the time. And it was exhausting. I had to be scrubbed every day, go to the tank. And you think, that's not going to happen to me. I can do anything. I can handle it. This is just some girl's story. I'm here to tell you, it will happen to you. You are 23 times more likely to have an accident texting me. So after I spent the last month, I finally got to come home the week of Christmas, and that was the best gift I could have been given. And then I was like, man, I'm really starting to understand. This is tough. My parents have to get me up and walk me around the house like every other hour to keep me moving so I didn't get a blood clot and die. I was still at risk for infection. I had an infection called Pseudomonas that would go septic in my blood 3 different times in the hospital, and that could have taken me out. My parents were told I might walk again because they had to remove so much from my body, remove all that dead tissue. Everything that was burned so badly, so deep. It was like 40 pounds off my back. I was a pretty big girl. So I get home, and now I go to more therapy. I'm an outpatient now. I went 3 times a week. I have to do physical therapy for my legs, occupational therapy for my arms, go to wound care, bandages daily. It's been 15 months now. I am still not healed. You think of a car accident of, I'm going to get broken bones. My car will get banged up. You don't think of burning alive in a car. You don't think these things are going to happen. I have to go to therapy now, 2 days a week still. And I've graduated from physical therapy. I can do pretty good. But I still have a lot to do with my arms, a lot of therapy for my hands and my arms. I have a condition now that's called HO. And what has happened is my elbows have burned so badly and burned to the bone. This bone is still exposed. We're trying to fix that. But it's burned so badly that the calcium has built up around the bone and it's frozen my joints. So I can't beat myself. I can't touch my face. I can't do my hair. I can't put my tops on. My mother has to help me with that. I have modified clothing. My clothes have to be tied on the sides so I can get my shirt on because I can't go over my head. I have a modified utensil to eat, which some of you, if you see me eating later, I'll have it to use, or I can reach my mouth that way. I drink out of straws. That's not typical, but my life is different now. My life is will forever be different now. Hopefully by next year, once my wounds heal, I'll be able to have the surgery where I can move my elbows again and touch my face, but we really don't know what's going to happen. We don't know what the future holds. All I do know is that my life was spared. I was saved for a reason. I was meant to be here today to talk to every one of you guys and to tell you what has happened to me and to learn from me. My parents, you don't realize what your actions and what you do. It involves everybody else that loves you, that is around you. Your sisters, your brothers, your parents. How they have to step up and take care of you when you're badly injured. I wasn't the best person before my accident. I did not have good leadership. I was pretty selfish. And now that's been taken away from me. And no matter how ugly I was to my parents, they stepped up to the plate and said, you are my child, and I'm going to do whatever it takes. My mother has had to quit her job to take care of me full time. I still have to be taken care of full time, 24/7. I need help with things. I can do a lot on my own, and it's getting there, but I still need help. They had to move from their hometown here in Crandon, Texas, where I was born and raised. They had to move to Dallas County, sell their home, and now we're renting a home in Dallas County just so I can get the care that I need, the proper care that it takes for me to get better. You don't understand how it affects those around you. You don't think of these things before the accident happens. And isn't it amazing that after all of this, and as much smoke and fire, that my lungs were not damaged? That wasn't another obstacle that I didn't have to go through, that I don't remember being burned. You can hear on the video how horrific it was. There was a lot more than that. That went on for over 10 minutes. The fire department finally showed up 20 minutes later. It's horrific. It should make you stop and think, I need good leadership in this life, and I need to stand up for myself, and my life is worth more than that. My life is worth more than the LOLs, or the see you laters, or the OMGs. It's not worth it. It's not worth you being a passenger in that car of somebody texting and they injure you or you kill somebody else. If I'd hurt somebody else or if my children would have been in the car with me, I couldn't stand here today and have as much joy in my life now. And how God, through all of this, suffering is a part of joy. And I wouldn't be able to meet you guys. I wouldn't be able to share my story with you. God spared me. I only lost 4 toes. I had a broken collarbone because I was wearing my seatbelt. Thank God. I wasn't thrown from my vehicle. And isn't it amazing how there were certain people there at the right time to render aid, call for help, had a crowbar in their vehicle, had an ice chest. I was right next to a little creek of water to throw that water on me. Isn't it amazing how God works and how he spares you from certain things? And I appreciate life so much more now. I love everybody. I'm just ecstatic to be alive and to be here and to take pride in putting away the dishes and to folding my clothes now. I take pride in those things. So the next time you're driving down the road and you get that text message and someone's needing to get a hold of you, it's not worth it to look at that phone, to even mess with it. Pull over if you have to. Get off the road. Stop what you're doing. And remember Jane. And it's just not worth it. So text later. Thank you. Thank you, Bobby.